Sarah is from Guatemala. She's a post-psychedelic quilt maker and a former LSD chemist. Jesse's interview. Sarah Matzar, isn't like other acid cooks. For starters, she is a woman, which besides Melissa Cargill and Rhoney Stanley of Owsley's lab and scattered others in the UK, is rare in LSD chemistry circles. Sarah is 4'10 and possesses a lacerating width. Look out. She's like, I'm 5'8. She's starting her own textile business and getting her master's in anthropology at UC Berkeley and studying Mayan art. And she's not here to save the world, so everyone put your questions away. Art is my guide, she says, and her guide manifests in the form of intricate Guatemalan quilt making, symbols, and systems colliding, which you'll see some of those beautiful quilts outside. My Guatemalan color sense combined with my psychedelic color sense, she says, in her quilting, she attempts to break out of the block, the traditional division and pattern making, and does so, the fabrics continuing their conversation across rippled quilted surfaces. So we'll have about a half an hour here for Jesse to interview Sarah, and we'll have a couple minutes for questions as well, and we'll have more time for questions in the panel.
Nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you too.
Without any delay.
White American male.
Here we go.
Sorry.
Let it begin.
I'm sorry. It's true.
Oh, well. I heard we were running out.
So
I wanted to talk about these kind of two parallel tracks that you were on that kind of both have pretty serious roots here in Berkeley. One is your art making and another is your chemistry. And I guess I wanted to start by sort of asking you to sort of talk about sort of what your life situation was when you arrived in Berkeley and how those two things kind of collided.
Well, I went to the all-famed Pacific High School in the Santa Cruz Mountains in the late 60s. And I guess training ground for being an instant deadhead, since they were just down the hill in Palo Alto and they were our school band. And so we had to go, of course, to all the free concerts in Palo Alto and the bookstore and everything. And, you know, after high school, I went back to Guatemala, where I lived and had my family until the early 80s. Towards the end of 1981, my country was in such political and violent turmoil that it was all I could do to break out of the metal box and get my mother and brother, sister, and two children up here, where I managed to get a scholarship in the Department of Anthropology at UC Berkeley. However, I had nowhere to live with my family, so or a job to support them and feed us. So close to, at the time, the Woolsey Street Hog Farm House, which is very close to the Ashby Bart, we'll say another perpendicular street home that was condemned, I quickly moved in. No electricity, no running water, but we got it from neighbors. And we actually lived there for 9 months like that. My family, while we go to the flea market to make a living, while I go to college, but I quickly had to make a real living. So, phase two, the fact that I went to Pacific High School prepped me for my future in the career of the 80s.
Good. Were you full on into quilting at that point? Were you doing what you do now?
Yeah, I was beginning to do quilting. I grew up weaving, knitting, weaving, crocheting, always being involved in textiles. I got my master's degree in Mesoamerican textiles. So always involved in textiles. Taking LSD in the Bay Area caused me to go to the Oakland Museum Quilt Show in the late 70s, where I suddenly saw this panorama of quilts that were not treated necessarily as something you throw on the bed to keep warm, but as emotional and personal statements of journeys of individual people. And I felt very connected to that feeling, that suddenly they were not just something to give away or make do with, but that they were personal expressions and statements of lifestyles.
Got my own.
Hey, we're in America. We don't have to share one.
And I guess sort of how did psychedelics continue to feed into your art practice, or did they?
They did, in the sense that it taught me to think laterally. It taught me to think outside my culture. Growing up extremely traditional, in the era of my growing up in Guatemala, you did not differ from your village traje. And I was one of the first young people who actively went to all language groups. We have 28 language groups besides Spanish. And learned weaving techniques, textile traditions, and spiritual traditions that interconnected us all. In that, I got back into mushrooms, being the one psychedelic that has always traditionally been used by shamans in my country. Coming to America, North America is LSD culture. This is where it's born. This is where it bred. It may have offshoots in other parts of Western world. And maybe some in Eastern or Central and South American, but it is basically a byproduct of North American culture. And the more I've studied anthropology, the more I've grown to really believe that it is a culturalism here. People come from all over the world to America, to North America, to experience this. They may take it home to Argentina, where there is a thriving psychedelic community. You know, you must know that. But it is through the North American experience, the North American cultural experience. And jokingly, but not surprising, it is a predominantly white, middle class, North American culturalism. Sorry, folks, but it's great to see so many women here tonight. God bless you.
Was there any other sort of influx of American psychedelic culture into where you were living in Guatemala?
Other than our own traditional shamanism, which is not proselytized, not really seen, heard, or done here by North American people at all, that I see. Even with our wetbacks that come here and try and fake it, they're doing a lousy job, you guys. They should just go home. They are. I mean, I've seen a lot of Guatemalan shamans try and interface that and are met with cultural ignorance, we'll say, because it is a North American cultural reality of how to network that, how to embrace that, how to even have the vocabulary to talk about it.
So I guess sort of maybe from an anthropological perspective, or just from your own perspective, I'm curious sort of what you saw sort of the practices of North American psychedelic culture being in the early 80s. How did you see that culture evolving?
Okay, well, I think that especially during the late 60s, United States being a grand melting pot, most North Americans are a byproduct of many cultures. You are a melting pot. Your parents could be Irish. Your parents could be Swedish. You could have Italian running through you. You are a huge melting pot. And so what happens here in North America in the 60s is, who do you learn cultural memory from? Your parents, your grandparents, your ancestors. But if they are in a deep state of cultural shock and confusion, what is it to be culturally a North American? Go to baseball games? Well, or go to football games, sports. Is sports your culture allowed? And I think what happened is a lot of people didn't buy that. Sports was not going to be their culture allowed. Soap operas were not going to be their culture allowed. There had to be more to life in North America than all these little boxes that you could fit yourself in. And so I think with music, and not just the Grateful Dead, I'm told that in the early 80s, the Metallica world were very big in LSD also. Maybe close to as big as the Deadhead world, but they were huge consumers of LSD in the early 80s, from like 82 to 86.
I did not
check
know
it
that.
Out. Check it out. Well. Metallica world loved LSD. And look at the artwork they produced 20 years later. It's pretty astounding when you think about it. In graphics as well as music. So there were all these things that people could relate to. Your country was at war also, even though it wasn't on your shores, like my country. You didn't have to deal with people being blown up every day. It was ethereal. It was on television. It was already virtual. How could you relate? How could you relate to being in this country? How, you know, where are you going to learn your cultural memory? Are you going to create it for your ancestors, for your children and your grandchildren to learn this cultural memory? You're at a loss. I mean, in a sense, many people felt like this in the late 60s and early 70s. They were like, where do I go? I don't want to be like my parents. You know, I don't want to be like my grandparents who came over on a ship from Italy. I don't want to be like this. How do I find myself in this country, in this reality? LSD was great bonding material for a lot of that at that particular time. I think the resurgence, maybe 15 or 18 years later, was more of that. I think that as you become assimilated, you become disassimilated as human beings. It's everywhere in the world, not just here. This is what I believe.
Were there other people that you encountered who were sort of using, practicing LSD use in sort of similar but different ways for, you know, expressions of art or?
Definitely. Definitely.
Or ones that struck you that you remember, sort of contemporaries, I guess.
Definitely. Yeah. Definitely. In the world, I mean, yeah, in the world of painting, in the world of sculpture, absolutely. And there would always come times, because I had so much responsibility in this country, and I had to calculate and always think about money, 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 money. So I had to look for jobs constantly as a way of marketing myself, my artwork. And so when I would get in a rut, which just happened very recently, I can find, this country's big enough, you can actually find some space somewhere out there and go out there and soul search, which is an incredibly North American libertine right. Correct. Yeah, I don't get to do that often at home. It's crowded there.
So could you tell us a little bit sort of the arc of your career as a cook? You know, sometimes you work for yourself, sometimes you work for other people. I know you work with a lot of women, which is pretty
I basically when I did work for myself, I tried to work around people that I could trust, which were predominantly women, which was very shocking, and not necessarily in the time and age viewed well. Like anthropology at the time, it was a male-dominated field. Totally, totally. And, you know, let us not forget, in 1983, it was also pretty outrageous for a woman to have her own bank account, her own money, her own everything, and do it on her terms. I don't think that many women who raised children, took care of their mother, ran a family, and did it on their own terms. I think that in itself was very rare here culturally, especially living in middle-class white America. I definitely oftentimes in the Bay Area felt that I was not white. I felt that I was not culturally part of this. I was oftentimes aghast at how people thought here, because at home it's totally normal. Women own everything. We own all the land. We run the marketplace. All the businesses, 80% of the businesses in my country are owned by women. So it was shocking to me to be in a country and a culture where it was the reverse, where everything is owned by men. And men make all the decisions as to, you know, whether you're socially adept at this or not, on very subtle levels. It was a very hard world to break into. I had a few men friends who backed me up as a person and as an artist. I'll say Bear. Bear backed me up big time as a person, as an artist, as a, go out there, woman, independently, on your own. I did oftentimes work for men because it's a job, and I did have a family to support, a college career I tried to get through, and a mother to take care of, and a country I wanted to go home to. And so by 1986, I had figured out that it was probably, I'd already been through the worst of the war in my country, that if I had to live here and deal with this, I kind of knew I couldn't do this. And I figured out then, for the worst or the best, maybe I go home to the devil I know. And I fought for 10 more years for the peace accord to come, which didn't come in my country until 97. So there were 7 years I was not allowed to come here. I was not issued a visa. I was not allowed to come here and make money. And that pretty much starved me out. Right after 9/11, I got my visa back the day after 9/11. Yeah. So now y'all have to put up with me because they ain't taking it away. They just gave it back to me, actually, 3 weeks ago. I got another 10 years of life, so I'm good.
Something that we were talking about earlier is that, you know, you come back here, you know, once or twice a year and sort of see how things change and how things evolve.
Oh, boy.
So I'm curious sort of what your take on kind of this current
psychedelic. I'm absolutely shocked on several levels. A, that the psychedelic community is still predominantly of a social and educational class. You haven't gotten very far in 40 years, you guys. I mean, thank you, women, for coming tonight. Every damn one of you, would you stand up and get an applause for me? I'm serious. All right, we're getting to closer to half now in this room. That's what we like. I'm appalled that it's still an extremely intellectual club, and that it's still predominantly white, middle class. Glad to see the women here. Finally, because even as little as 15 years ago, it was still a pretty male-dominant club. Because they were the ones who had the money for the college education, obviously. So it's still a pretty university-based communication networking system. My guess is everybody in here has graduated from high school. but that's my guess. So it is still a very intellectual circle, as opposed to people who are dealing with hand-to-mouth, hands-on reality of day-to-day life.
Do you see a way of integrating psychedelics into the society outside of
the intellectual world? Absolutely. But one factor I always thought on why the rise of LSD went skyrocketed in the mid to late 80s had to do with price and finances. And one of the reasons it closed down was also because of that price. As I said to Jesse today, only in the last 4 years have I heard of a gram of crystal in this town being sold for under $10,000. So that's pretty good. When you consider at one point it was only $2,000. And then it went up, and then it went up. So of course high school kids couldn't get LSD at a price range they could afford. If you look at what high school and young college kids really spend on their drugs and what they get, you'd be pretty amazed at that too. And so that's a lot of the control, I think, is the economics, excuse me.
I mean, one aspect that's been one thing that's been happening is really this globalization of the psychedelic world. And, people go traveling to Central and South America.
Well, how globalized is it? Who gets the LSD?
Well, but more, people traveling specifically to South America to take part in ceremonies. And I was curious sort of what your take on that is, and if you've seen it, sort of what you've observed.
I'm absolutely dumbfounded. I'm sort of appalled because I guess as I repeat myself and say LSD is clearly a North American culturalism. God bless you guys. But ayahuasca is not a North American culturalism. So who controls, who markets, who makes the money on? I ask all these questions on the huge influx of controlled shamanistic behavior around ayahuasca. I'm really at a loss to what I really think of it entering the North American world, because I think it's so taken out of cultural context that it doesn't work here. I think it's confusing. I do think it's really confusing. I think it's also changed. There are aspects of it that North Americans don't want to deal with, i.e. the vomiting. So they can alter it somehow, or alter themselves, or the whole ideology of the process of what it is in its cultural context. And so something like that, I'm not very good on thinking that, not that it shouldn't be shared, but I'm not sure the huge influx of altering its cultural context really does anything for North Americans. I mean, it's a great thing to study, I guess, but I don't think culturally it works here in the same way. And I guess I feel that way about the type of mushrooms we do in certain Mayan ceremonies. It doesn't culturally read out to you guys. You don't have the same belief system. And the people who do ayahuasca have a specific set belief system that they're already born into. Sort of like Mormons are born into their belief system and they think everybody around them is just like them. I mean, that's one cultural context. But so LSD is your cultural context. It's been in your culture the longest. You've had the most percentage of population evolve and grow with it. We're at many generations later. I have grandchildren who take LSD now. What can I say? But so I understand that, you know, that aspect of it too. So I don't have a good reading of all this. I think maybe Americans are psychically bored. I wonder that within their own framework, they're constantly looking for psychoactive activity. But that may be what it is to be a North American. I don't know. Yeah.
I mean, this might be a good time to start open up the conversation and see if people have things they'd like to ask or chime in.
Do you have any questions?
I appreciate what you say about the culture of the mushrooms, about the culture of the mushrooms in the ayahuasca. But I wanted to comment that my experience has been with people who've gone to Mexico and been trained to administer mushrooms, and my experience has been a relationship with the earth, not with the intellect. And so I just wonder if you mean that.
Well, I'm glad you had a really great personal experience with the earth. I'm not sure I believe anybody is really trained to administer any of that. I'm not sure that I believe that because of the tradition that I grew up around it. It's not for one person to administer and guide and be trained in that for people, like in my culture. So I think it's a way of interfacing for financial gain, especially with ayahuasca, from what I understand. You know, visas are a trick, girl. Making a living out of this country all year round for every Central and South American is a trick. If we can somehow figure a way to interface up here with whatever knowledge and whatever goodness and whatever we can, we will. That's part of who, you know, culturally, at least for Central Americans, who we are. But yeah, there's that context thing. It's, you know, I see more with ayahuasca. So many people claim they're trained, but what does that really mean? What does that really mean culturally? In the culture that ayahuasca comes from, what does that really mean in North American culture? How do you translate that? How do you transcend that? Because it's not for one person to oversee somebody else. And then there's the whole financial gain of it. Who's making the money? You thought about that? I have. Who's making the money?
Sarah, thank you so much for bringing your, over here, in the middle, right in front.
Okay, hi.
I just really appreciate the feminist and woman power perspective, and I'm really glad you named all that. Something that I've really struggled with, in my personal experience in ayahuasca and these sort of medicine circles that are springing up, like mushrooms everywhere around the Bay Area, is that I've noticed this fetishization of the indigenous and of the indigenous wanting to bring those cultures back, but in our own way, but sort of also culturally backpedaling, particularly with sexism and patriarchy. And I'm really confused as well if it is possible to use those medicines in a way that both honors the traditions they come from and honors the reality of our culture now with queerness and with women visibility and with gender fluidity and sort of do away with some of those structures. So I guess it's not so much a question as much as just my personal experience I just see really reflected in what you're saying right now.
Well, I wonder if there's enough time. I guess as an anthropologist, I believe you need to go immerse yourself in that culture and that belief system and decide if it resonates inside you, if your heart resonates with that consciousness. Even before the ayahuasca, long before the mushrooms, you know, does your heart resonate with the indigenous knowledge of that culture enough to, you know, go that direction? Is your ultimate gain to gain knowledge through the mushrooms or the ayahuasca, or to gain cultural perspective? Or do you have cultural perspective enough to be part of that community? That's what I would say. I find it, you know, difficult at best for shamans. I see it. I know a lot of them well, at least the ones from my country. There's a lovely guy out in Point Richmond. Great guy. Was my neighbor for 20-something years. And, you know, he believes he has the power to share knowledge. But what does that really break down and mean? And he's recently come to me saying, Sarah, you were really right. They don't have a clue. We automatically, like you guys automatically in America, can relate to hamburgers, hot dogs, baseball, all these cultural emblems. They resonate to you. But it's very difficult when someone's trying to teach you a spiritual consciousness or a worldview. We won't even call it a spiritual consciousness because that's not even what it is, but a worldview. And so without that worldview, those drugs mean nothing. One thing that many LSD chemists decided in the early 80s was the world, the consciousness of a 250 micro hit was being wasted on the general public. Because it wasn't like you were getting any higher, seeing any more truth, learning any more than a 100 mic hit. And as a matter of fact, as a public base in a rock concert, you were a hell of a lot more manageable on those 100 hit mics, rather than everybody being out there on 250 mics, who really had no preparation for that. But what we did find out is nobody got any more, I mean, people got just as fucked up on the 100 mics and saw God just as clearly.
I think a very important aspect of psychedelics in 2016 that we haven't talked about yet is the movement towards research and potential prescription usage of these substances for particular medical disorders. And you know, as a psychiatrist, I can see the reasons for doing that and the reasons to control a lot of the aspects of set and setting. But I certainly, particularly with what you've said this evening, can see a lot of concerns of doing it in within that model. What do you think?
Wow, that'd be a long discussion we'd have privately, dear. Are you really a psychiatrist? Great. Wow. I guess, how old are you? Maybe it's my age and how I was raised to believe about psychiatry. I'm maybe not that knowledgeable in the field of it. I understand it's its own medicine field. You can write prescriptions for drugs. I know in my country, the drug companies run you all wild, you psychiatrists. And there are so many levels of those that are going for no drugs, and many who want more LSD research. As a matter of fact, my son's psychiatrist would really wish that he had access to more LSD research on schizophrenics. I think there's definitely should be a format of research, as I said earlier. It is your club. It is an intellectual college university based culture. So you shouldn't have too hard a time being able to do your research with or without the blessings of the government. You have to decide if you want their blessing or not. You have to decide if you want to suggest it, write it. In a legal format, it will probably be after I'm dead. Because I don't think that many people feel like you. But I might be wrong here. Maybe more people are open to that reality. It's a new world in that reality. Though I think if Ken Kesey were alive, he'd say, honey, it's the reason they hauled my ass in there. Like that, you know, that's what he was, a guinea pig. So, unknown what kind of research goes on in that field today. I'm really pretty ignorant. Sorry.
Well, thank you very much. A big round of applause for Sarah and Jesse.